In this video, we quickly derived the formula relating the net force on an extended body and the center of mass acceleration of that body. Then we're going to apply our new formula to analyzing a classic mechanics problem where we find the normal force on a chain that's falling onto a table. So we start things out with a look at an extended body. And any extended body can be broken into individual point masses. I've labeled a few of these as M1, M2, and M3. And that would go all the way up to some mn, where n is the total number of particles that we're breaking it into. I've also included the center of mass position vector, and I marked the center of mass with an x because that's going to matter in a minute. And before we get started with Newton's second law, it's important to distinguish between two types of forces that are felt by these particles. We can have external force. So that's a force on a particle coming from outside the extended body. And for us, that would usually be the force of gravity. And then each particle may experience internal forces as well. And those are particle-to-particle interactions within the extended body. For example, those could be the electrostatic forces that bind together a solid object. So next, we're going to apply Newton's second law to every single particle this thing is made of. And I can say the net force on the ith particle is equal to the mass of the ith particle times its acceleration. So if I can just grab particle number 2 for a second, just to illustrate, it might have the force of gravity pulling down on it, but it might also have some interaction forces with nearest neighbors. These are all internal forces that are binding that particle into place. So what we're going to do is break the net force on the ith particle into internal and external forces. So now we're using a subscript, and I have F net external on the ith particle plus F net internal on the ith particle. That's going to be equal to the mass of the ith particle times its acceleration. And next, we're going to sum over all the particles in the entire body. On the left-hand side, the sum of all the net internal forces on each particle is going to vanish. And the reason this happens is that every internal force on every particle is canceled pairwise with a reaction force, according to Newton's third law, that has the exact same magnitude but the opposite direction. So if I go to my diagram, M2 is apparently being pulled to the left by some internal force, if I just put a dot next to that one. And that means another particle in the body is being pulled to the right with the exact same magnitude but the opposite direction. The vector sum of those two forces is 0. And this is true across every single pair of internal forces in the object. So when we sum over every single object in the extended body, that sum vanishes. I also want to make a point about the first sum on the left-hand side. So that's the sum of the net force from external sources on the ith particle over all the particles from 1 to n. And it's a subtle point here, but this is actually a double sum because the net force on the ith particle is a sum of all the external forces on that particle itself. So when I take the sum of all the external forces on the ith particle and I do this for all the particles as I goes from 1 to n, that gives me the sum of every single external force acting on this extended body. And we can just write this as the sum of all external forces. And on the right-hand side, we still have the sum of all the individual masses multiplied by their acceleration vectors. So the right-hand side rings a bell. This is somehow related to the center of mass. And here's just a quick reminder of the center of mass position vector. And I'll post a link to the video where this was derived. The center of mass position vector that's shown in the diagram, it points from the origin to the center of mass of this body. It's given by 1 over the total mass of all the particles in the system times the sum of each mass multiplied by its position vector. And we commonly use this by multiplying both sides by big M, the total mass of the object. So the total mass times the center of mass position vector is going to be the sum of all the products of each mass with its position vector. And the thing I have on the right side of the equation I'm working with, that looks very similar to that. It's just that I have an acceleration vector instead of a position vector. So I'm going to rewrite this in terms of a time derivative of a position vector. And of course, acceleration is the second time derivative of position. But the mass of the ith particle is not changing with time, so I can move it inside the time derivative. That's just a constant. And the sum of all these time derivatives of these individual terms is equal to the time derivative of the sum of the terms. And now I recognize that sum as being the total mass multiplied by the center of mass position vector. But the total mass is a constant as well, and I can move that out in front. And then the second time derivative of the position vector for the center of mass, well, that's just the acceleration vector for the center of mass. So I end up with total mass times the acceleration of the center of mass vector. And that completes our derivation of a really important formula for mechanics. If I look at the sum of all external forces acting on an object, that's going to be equal to the total mass multiplied by the center of mass acceleration. And there are a variety of classic problems that require this more powerful general approach. When you go beyond solving simple Atwood machines and blocks sliding down ramps and that sort of thing, and you start solving more sophisticated mechanics problems, this is often the tool you're going to use. So let's check out an example of how to put this new formula to work. I have a chain suspended vertically just above a table. It has a length of L and a mass of M, so we're just staying very general here. And it's released from rest. And as it falls, the chain piles up on this table, and I want to know what's the normal force exerted on the chain by the table as a function of the fall distance, x. And it's important to note here that the normal force exerted on the table is not just the amount required to hold up the piece that's laying on the table. The normal force exerted by the table has to be greater than that. And the reason why is that part of the normal force is stopping these links that are moving faster and faster as they slam into the table. So our normal force is going to exceed the weight of the chain that's just laying on the table. So the plan here is to apply our new formula. The sum of all external forces on an extended body is equal to the total mass times the center of mass acceleration. And that's a vector equation in general. Of course, we're really just working in one dimension here, so we're going to handle directions by using just plus and minus signs. Well, if I go ahead and use the standard convention of saying that upward is positive and downward is negative, that net external force on the chain will be the normal force pointing up minus the force of gravity on the entire chain, big M G. And this means that if we're able to find the center of mass acceleration of the chain, we'll be able to add mg to both sides and solve for the normal force. So that's the real challenge of the problem. How do we find the center of mass acceleration of this chain? And there's a physical fact that's going to be useful in this derivation. The part of the chain that's still falling is free falling. So we can say its acceleration is going to have a magnitude of g. And some of you may be aware of this fact, but this is really just a first approximation for how to solve this chain problem. It actually turns out, if you look at it in the lab, that the end of the chain will be accelerating a little bit faster than g from the links below it pulling on it. But that goes way beyond the scope of our introductory physics course. So we're going to use this first approximation that the chain part that's still falling is just free falling with an acceleration of about 9.8 meters per second squared. So our major challenge here is to find the acceleration of the center of mass of this thing. And after that, we just plug into our new formula for the sum of all external forces, and we'll get our normal force real quick. So what I want to do first is just try to identify the location of the center of mass of this chain. And what I'm going to do is just break it into two pieces. One piece is the piece that's still vertical, and its geometric center is the center of mass of that piece. The other piece is laying on the table, and its geometric center is the center of mass of that piece. Now we can treat those two pieces as point masses located at their center of mass. And we use the center of mass formula for point masses. So the y center of mass coordinate is going to be 1 over the total mass of this thing. And then we take the sum of each point mass multiplied by its y coordinate. And the vertical piece is the interesting piece. The mass of that is going to be the fraction of the chain that it represents. So it has a length of L minus x, because the chain started with a length of L and it fell by a distance of x already. So I take L minus x over L, that gives me the fraction of the chain that's still standing up vertically. And if I multiply that by the total mass of the chain, it gives me the mass of that vertical section. And then I need to multiply by the y coordinate of its center, which is then L minus x divided by 2. For my second term in the center of mass formula, the part that's laying on the table, well, it has a y coordinate of 0, so I know this term is going to vanish. But just to be thorough, the mass of it is going to be the fraction of the chain it represents, and that's a length of x divided by a length of L multiplied by the mass of the entire chain. And the y-coordinate of that piece, again, is 0, so that term vanishes. So the mass is going to cancel out of this, and I end up with a 1 over 2L, pulling out those two denominators, times the quantity L minus x all squared for the center of mass y-coordinate as a function of the fall distance. And it's wise in a general problem like this to check at each step that our answer makes physical sense. So here's the check on my work. If x is 0, the chain hasn't even started falling yet, and I can see the center of mass should be L over 2. So let's make sure that happens. If I plug in x equals 0, I get L squared over 2L. One of the L's cancels, and I get L over 2. So that's good. What if x is equal to L? That's when the entire chain is laying on the table at a y-coordinate of 0. The center of mass should be 0. And when I plug in L for x, I can see that that term vanishes. I get a 1 over 2L times a 0 squared. I get 0. Okay, so this formula is doing what it's supposed to be doing. Now our goal, of course, is to get to the acceleration of the center of mass, and right now we have its position. So we start taking time derivatives. The velocity of the center of mass, that's going to be the first time derivative. And it's not as simple as it might look at first because I have L minus x all squared. This is a function of a function. So to take the derivative, I have to use the chain rule. I differentiate with respect to the interior. That gives me a 2 times the quantity L minus x. And then I have to differentiate the interior with respect to t because this is a time derivative. Well, L is not a function of time, but x is. So I end up with a negative dx dt. And dx dt is the velocity of this tip of the chain. So if you like, you can replace dx dt with a v. And I'll clean up by canceling a factor of 2 there. So I get a negative 1 over L times L minus x v, where that v stands for the velocity of the tip of the chain, not the velocity of the center of mass. And what I want to check on this formula in terms of physical reasonableness is that the velocity of the center of mass should be a negative quantity. X we're treating as positive, dx dt we're treating as positive, but v center of mass has got to be negative because that y center of mass should be getting smaller as the chain starts to pile up on the table. And certainly x is less than L, so this first piece is going to be positive. V, the rate of change in x, we're treating that as positive in our setup, so that's positive as well. And there's a minus sign out in front, so this guarantees that the center of mass velocity is always negative. This makes physical sense. The next step is to take yet another time derivative, and the negative 1 over L is a spectator there. And this requires the product rule because x is a function of time and v is a function of time as well as this chain speeds up. So I have a product of two functions of time. I have to use the product rule. When I differentiate that first function of time, I have negative dx dt from that first term, but that's v. So I have a negative v and then multiplied by a v for the second function. Then I add to this the first function left alone and the time derivative of the second function, which is going to be the acceleration of the tip of the chain, which we're assuming is equal to g. So the acceleration of the tip of the chain can be replaced with g. Again, the real physical solution is slightly more complicated, but this is a good first approximation. What about the speed of the tip of the chain? We have to do a quick kinematics calculation for this. So we're saying the part of the chain that's still falling through the air is free falling. It's been accelerating with a magnitude of g for a distance of x. And so we use our classic kinematics formula for this. V squared is equal to V naught squared plus twice the acceleration times x minus x naught. And our initial velocity is 0. We're treating x as an increasing quantity, the way that we set up our diagram and all of our calculations. And so we're going to plug in a equals positive g. Final x position will be called x. The initial x position will be called 0. So v squared can be replaced with a 2 times g times x. Now we've got that the center of mass acceleration is negative 1 over L. And then negative v squared for the velocity of the tip of the chain can be replaced with a negative 2gx. And the acceleration of the tip of the chain can be replaced with a g. So I'll go ahead and pull a g out while I'm working on the next step. I have negative g over L. And then I have a negative 2x minus an x. So I have a negative 3x in these parentheses. And a plus L. And again, just checking for the physical reasonableness of our solution. If I plug in x equals 0, that's when the chain was first starting to fall, I should find that the center of mass acceleration is just equal to negative g because the whole thing is just in free fall momentarily. So if I plug in x equals 0, then inside the parentheses that reduces to an L, the L cancels and I get the center of mass acceleration is equal to negative g. So this is doing what it's supposed to be doing. Finally, we go back to our original formula for net force and center of mass acceleration. And I have that the net external force is going to be the normal force minus the force of gravity on the entire chain. And that's got to be equal to the total mass of the chain times the center of mass acceleration. And I'm going to write inside this parentheses as an L minus 3x. So we'll go ahead and solve for the normal force. And I'm going to add mg to both sides. And then I have to clean things up on that right-hand side. I have a negative mg over L multiplied by L. Well, that's negative mg. And then my second term is going to be a positive mg over L times 3x. Those mg's cancel out in front. And I'm going to go ahead and emphasize that this normal force is a function of x. So I'm going to call it n of x. And I get 3mgx. Now, when x is equal to L, the normal force is going to be 3mg. And this is pretty surprising because it far exceeds the weight of the chain. Again, I knew it had to be bigger than the weight of the chain because the normal force is responsible for stopping all of those links as they hit the table, in addition to supporting the chain that's already at rest on the table. But I wouldn't expect it to be this much bigger. It's just the way it turns out. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.